first thing I wanted us to do was to kind of have a quiet time and start with an opening prayer. I want to just thank all of you for coming out tonight. It is important for us to stop on Good Friday, I believe, and to remember the cross, remember what Jesus Christ accomplished for us on the cross. And so I thought we would start with prayer. So let us go to the Lord in prayer. Father, we just want to thank you for your presence here in this place. We thank you for all the sacrifices that have been made through the years to make this church possible. And for this prayer garden, we dedicate it to you for your use, for people to come and to pray and to meditate here in this garden. We remember Jesus Christ, but we also want to thank you for all the people that are here tonight. We pray for each of us we might remember on Good Friday what Jesus Christ did for us so that we can live. We look forward to Sunday when we'll celebrate the resurrection of Jesus Christ. We pray that in his name. Amen.
Amen.
I wanted to just start with a couple of comments. And the first thing I wanted to say is, anytime you come into a garden place is a place where normally you have growing plants and trees and so forth. A lot of us are protective. If you've ever raised a garden and you have children, you know one of the things you always tell children is, don't go in the garden because you don't want them to tear up your vegetables and your fruit and so forth. But in this place, we want all people to come. Children, youth, adults, we want people to be free to come and use this place. It's a place for prayer, and it's a place for people just to have a quiet time with God. So we're here to dedicate this garden to God. It's a memorial garden, and it's a place where we can come. And I'm going to hand out some cards. These cards have names of people that we're remembering here in this garden. You may be able to add more memorials to people in the future, and we'll plant another tree or put another bench out here for you. I'm going to ask somebody to take these cards and just pass them around. So Richard, would you just take these cards and take one card and then pass the cards along. Everybody take one card, and then we'll start reading the names of the people that we're remembering here in this place. You'll probably notice on the benches and in front of every tree, there's a memorial placard, and the memorial placard has the name of someone who was a part of this church, the life of this church, or someone that a family in the church is remembering from their family. And so that's why this you see these memorial plaques all over the garden. So one of the things, and Mark Nelson did a lot of the work, and Duke McCartney helped him to get this ready for us to be able to use it. And I thank you, Mark, for that, and Duke. And others, I think Val helped. I'm not sure all the people that helped out here, but I thank you for whoever helped. You'll notice there's white roses around the cross, and there's red roses in front of it, and that's to remind us that Jesus Christ, although he was without sin, took our sin upon himself, and it was by his blood that we received forgiveness of our sins. So that's why there's white roses and red ones in the front. And you also notice the cross is empty because as Christians, we remember that Jesus Christ was buried and he rose again. He's not here. His Holy Spirit's here, but his body, he ascended. He's in heaven today at the right hand of God the Father, praying for us. So when you pray here, remember Jesus is praying for you while you pray. And so that's important. I would like us to just take a moment and read the names of people. I think it's important for us to remember, right? Can we just remember some of these people? Just go on around. We'll start over here and just go on around. So, yeah, go ahead, Mark.
I've got John Hale and Bob O'Brien.
Yeah, two very, very significant members of our church.
Amen.
Linda?
Boy, this is hard, but Ida Hindenman.
Ida Hinman, uh-huh.
And Betty Hinman.
Right.
Bill Hinman.
Right.
Junior.
Right.
Okay.
One for
okay.
Wait, I can't hear any of those.
Julia?
Kurt Martin.
Kurt Martin.
And Wayne. And what was yours? Wayne? Fuller.
And Wayne Fuller. Kurt Martin was a deacon in our church and a very, very faithful member of our church. He moved to Arizona and he died there in Arizona not long ago. Oh, Kay and Everett Crosswind.
Yeah.
The reason we were able to refurbish the worship center was because they remembered the church first in their will.
Wesley Clapp, Deborah Jean Bradshaw.
And Jean and Walter Nash.
Jean and Walter Nash, right? Roy?
Colton Parrott and Haley Alyssa.
Haley Alyssa. Mm-hmm.
William and Wilma Hutchison.
Yeah. Bill and Wilma. I never knew him as William.
Well, you wrote it as William.
Yeah, I know. That's what it said. Bill and Wilma.
You told me to read it. I read it.
Yeah, you did
Mom
good.
And Dad. Marcia and Kathy.
Good.
And
what you got?
Burris.
All right. Russ?
Marvin Schmidt.
Marvin Schmidt was a man who, he visited people. He would stay all night with them in the hospital from our church if they were in the hospital. Don't ever forget him. Great guy.
Edison Baginero.
Edison Baginero. That's the Baginero son. Yep, he's a car captain. Yep.
Stanley Valak.
Thank you.
Valak.
Stanley Valak. His tree's over here.
Dorothy's husband.
Cindy Johnson.
And Cindy Johnson.
Oh,
yeah.
Our
Tanya's. Edna?
Grace Mays.
Grace Mays.
Ron Higginbottom.
Ron Higginbottom. That's Dwayne's brother, right? What will people remember about us? Will we have been faithful to the Lord Jesus Christ? Will we be faithful to His Word? Will we tell people about Jesus, how they can be saved? That's what I want to do. I want somebody to remember me as being faithful to the end. Anyway, I thought what we ought to do is, I had kind of an idea, and I thought about, this is a garden, prayer garden, but the Bible tells us about a number of different important gardens, and I asked Pastor Kirk if he would share a word with us about one of those gardens, the first one mentioned in the Bible.
Pastor, do you mind, what if we sing I Come to the Garden?
I love it. You want to lead us?
Sure.
Okay.
Can you guys all sing with me? I come to the garden alone. Yeah. Danny, you gonna help me out here?
Danny
Let's
will
all
help.
Sing. I have a tendency to go too high, so I'm gonna try not to do that.
I come to the garden alone.
There we go.
I had an old preacher that told me one time, he said, the only thing wrong with that song is, he said, I want everybody else to know the same joy.
Yes.
When it says no other has ever known, he said, I want everyone to know that joy. Great preacher. Well, I was thinking about us reading some scriptures and talking about some other gardens, which leads up to this garden. So, Pastor Kirk, would you be willing to maybe read some scripture?
You ready?
Yeah, sure.
I'm going to read a couple of verses to you. Genesis chapter 2 says, and the Lord God planted a garden eastward in Eden, and there he put the man whom he had formed. And out of the ground made the Lord God to grow every tree that is pleasant to the sight and good for food.
I don't need it.
Good. And the tree of life also in the midst of the garden, and the tree of the knowledge of good and evil. And the Lord God took the man and put him into the garden of Eden to dress it and to keep it. And the Lord God commanded the man, saying, of every tree of the garden thou mayest freely eat. But of the tree of the knowledge of good and evil thou shalt not eat of it, for in the day that thou eatest thereof thou shalt surely die. Just so a couple thoughts about it. Our our Father in heaven, God, made, of course, the Garden of Eden, created it, and he created it for a purpose. He created it for a place, a special place for Adam and Eve to dwell. Of course, it was a place that was beautiful. It was perfect. It was everything that we would want. It was the perfect garden. Can you imagine having a garden without bugs? I mean, can you imagine having a garden without weeds? It was perfect. And it was, there wasn't even sin there, but man figured out a way to mess it up. But the most special thing, the most important thing about the Garden of Eden is that there was no hindrance between God and man.
That's right.
And God walked with Adam in the garden. Isn't that a beautiful story?
It is.
And the presence of God was with them. They dwelt together and they talked together in the cool of the day. The Bible speaks of it often. And just so we know that this is no form of the Garden of Eden, but it is good to allude to the fact that this is a place where we can have the presence of God with us. We know that God is with us everywhere, right. But there is something about special about being in nature with God, spending time with him. And just think about that today and your future, being able to walk with God. This would be a good place for you to do that.
Sure. Thank you, brother. Genesis 3:1 says, "Now the serpent was more subtle than any beast of the field which the Lord God had made. And he said unto the woman, Yea, hath God said, Ye shall not eat of every tree of the garden? And the woman said unto the serpent, We may eat of the fruit of the trees of the garden, but of the fruit of the tree which is in the midst of the garden, God hath said, Ye shall not eat of it, neither shall ye touch it, yet lest ye die. And the serpent said unto the woman, Ye shall not surely die, for God doth know that in the day ye eat thereof, then your eyes shall be opened, and ye shall be as gods, knowing good and evil. And when the woman saw that the tree was good for food, and it was pleasant to the eyes, and a tree to be desired to make one wise, she took of the fruit thereof, and did eat, and gave also unto her husband with her, and he did eat. And the eyes of them both were opened, and they knew that they were naked, and they sewed fig leaves together, and made themselves aprons. And they heard the voice of the Lord walking in the garden in the cool of the day. And Adam and his wife hid themselves from the presence of the Lord God among the trees of the garden. And the Lord called unto Adam, and said unto him, Where art thou? And he said, I heard thy voice in the garden, and I was afraid, because I was naked, and I hid myself. And he said, Who told thee that thou wast naked? Hast thou eaten of the tree whereof I commanded thee that thou shouldst not eat? And the man said, The woman, of course, whom thou gavest to be with me, she gave me of the tree, and I did eat. To this day, everything my wife puts in front of me, I eat it.
Yeah. Amen.
Yeah, I do.
All the men said amen.
All the men said amen. Yeah. We're not talking about sin, though. My wife's a good wife, and she tries to keep me on the straight path, that's for sure. But I wanted to say that that's how we got into all this trouble. And the only reason why we remember Jesus Christ and his death on the cross is because if I'd have been there, I would have done it. I know I am a sin. I have a sin nature,
right?
My old nature. So we can't just blame them. And by the way, when Eve took of the fruit, her husband was standing there and didn't speak up. He should have said something. It's really his fault that she did what she did, because he should have told Satan to get lost. The other thing I thought about is there was another garden. It was the Garden of Gethsemane. It's a place where Jesus Christ went to pray, which this is a prayer garden, but that's a different one where he went. And it says in Matthew 26, Then cometh Jesus with them unto a place called Gethsemane, and saith unto the disciples, Sit ye here while I go and pray yonder. And he took with him Peter and the two sons of Zebedee, and began to be sorrowful and very heavy. Then saith he unto them, My soul is exceeding sorrowful, even unto death. Tarry ye here and watch with me. And he went a little further and fell on his face and prayed, saying, O my Father, if it be possible, let this cup pass from me. Nevertheless, not as I will, but as thou wilt. And he cometh unto the disciples, and finding them asleep, saith unto Peter, What could you not watch with me 1 hour? Have you ever prayed for an hour? Just an hour. Jesus Christ prayed, it records in this story, 3 times in this case, He prayed, went back to check on his followers. They were asleep. Went back and prayed again. The second time he prayed, if this cup could be taken from him. He was sweating, thinking about what he was going to take upon himself. He took the sin of all of our sin on himself and suffered and died on the cross. But when he was thinking about it, he knew what was coming. He already knew what he's facing. And so Jesus Christ went and said the second time, and he said, if this cup may not pass away from me, except I drink it, thy will be done. We are supposed to grow up to become like Jesus Christ. That means in our life, no matter what comes, we should be ready to say, thy will be done. Whatever the Lord wants, that's what we should be willing to agree to and to be obedient to God. One of our problems is when we think we know better than God, or we think like, well, maybe God's not watching me or paying any attention. That's why people used to do a lot of things in the dark. They thought, well, God only sees in the day, you know, and he doesn't see at night. The truth is, he sees all the time. He knows us. He knows our thoughts even before we've done or said something. We need to be careful and about our life. And then there's another garden, the third garden, and that's the garden of the tomb. And the reason I wanted to come here at this particular time is to remember on Good Friday, Jesus died. Before the sun went down in Israel on that day, he was buried. And so we're coming to a sunset, not a sunrise. This is really a day for a sunset service to remember he was buried for us, died and then buried for us before the sun even went down. It says, they took the body, they wound it in linen clothes as the and with the spices as a manner of the Jews is to bury, and in the place. Now in the place where he was crucified, there was a garden. So that's the second garden. And the third garden. And in the garden, a new sepulcher wherein no man was yet laid. There laid they Jesus, therefore, because of the Jews' preparation day, for the sepulcher was nigh at hand. That means the grave where he was buried was in this third garden. We had the Garden of Eden. We had the Garden of Gethsemane where he prayed. And now they're in the garden where the tomb. Very near the cross where he was crucified. And so you and I know the rest of the story. The Romans set a guard on it. They had a Roman seal on the stone. The stone probably weighed several tons. Just by the size of it would have weighed 5,000-6,000 pounds. No way a couple of ladies could have come and just rolled it away. When the ladies got there, it says, upon the first day of the week, very early in the morning they came unto the sepulcher, bringing spices which they prepared, and certain others with them, and they found the stone rolled away. I'm sure they were glad that it was rolled away. And they entered in and found not the body of the Lord Jesus. And it came to pass, as they were much perplexed thereabout, behold, two men stood by them in shining garments. And as they were afraid and bowed their faces to the earth, they said unto them, why seek ye the living among the dead? He's not here, but is risen. Remember how he spake unto you when he was yet in Galilee, saying, the Son of Man must be delivered into the hands of sinful men and be crucified, and the third day rise again. And they remembered his words and returned from the sepulchre and told all these things unto the 11 and to all the rest. It was Mary Magdalene and Joanna and Mary, the mother of James, and the other women that were with them, which told these things unto the apostles. And like a lot of men, it says, their words seemed to them as idle tales, and they believed them not. They told the truth. They went to the grave, and he wasn't there. It was an empty grave.
Hallelujah.
Praise God.
Amen.
Isn't that awesome?
Yeah.
So when we come here, this is a place we're dedicating for people to come and to pray to the same Lord that died for us. Don't ever wonder, did he love you? Of course he did. He proved it by giving his life for you and for me. So when you come here, use this as a place. It's a holy place, but it's just a garden, you know? The one that makes it special is the one who gave his life for us, okay? That's the whole point. And we should always remember those who were faithful before us. The reason I think a good teaching for us to remember to be like them and be faithful ourselves. We want people to remember us for our faith in Christ, not something else. We want them to remember we were faithful and yielded to him. Amen? Word of prayer, because the sun is almost ready to go down. And I think it's appropriate for us, just like they did, to leave just before the sun goes down. You know, on that day, the reason why they buried him before the sun went down? It's the beginning of the Sabbath. The Sabbath begins when the sun sets. I had one lady tell me I was crazy. That everybody knows the day starts when the sun rises. And I said, not in the Jewish mindset. It was when the sun went down is the beginning. And when just before it set was the end of the day. So we're at the end of the day, Friday. The Sabbath is just getting ready to start, actually. So I'm going to ask Brother Kirk, would you lead us in a closing prayer?
I'd love to.
I love it. Thank you, sir.
Dear Heavenly Father, we thank you so much for the opportunity to be here tonight together as a church family. We pray that you would be with us on this Good Friday and that we would do all that would be honorable to you, Lord. We thank you for your death on the cross.
Amen.
And the victory that you instilled and gave to us, victory over sin, victory over death, and victory over hell, and giving us eternal life in heaven. Lord, we pray that as we continue this weekend, tomorrow, as we do outreach and many of the men working at the church, Lord, that also this Sunday, Lord, that we would be a wonderful day celebrating the resurrection of our Lord and Savior. Bless us, Lord. We ask this in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen.
Are we having breakfast?
We have a breakfast.
Can we
remind them?
Yeah.